And so I had asked the people that originally opened up if I could step in today and just share what I feel like he's trying to reveal to us. He's been pressing upon me to read the book of Jeremiah. And the minute I opened the book of Jeremiah, I felt like God really revealed the message. And so I'm going to share several different scriptures, and then I'll pull together at the end what I feel that he is trying to reveal to us. And I'll tell you this, when I was reading in Jeremiah, I've read the book before, it's been a while since I've revisited, but it really sparked me to know that when God spoke to him, he just went. He didn't question it. God gave him a word, and he just went. He had the ear for the word, and he had an ear to hear the word from God and spoke the truth to the people when God commanded it. So in Jeremiah 1:5, this is out of the Amplified Version, it says this, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew and approved of you as my chosen instrument. And before you were born, I separated and set you apart, consecrating you, and I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." So just as we heard right there, he has set everybody here that has been saved by Christ, he has set you apart to be a prophet to the nations. So in Jeremiah 1:7-10, it says this, "For you shall go to all to whom I shall send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Be not afraid of them, their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand, and he touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day appointed you to the oversight of the nations and of the kingdoms, to root out, pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." In chapter 5, verse 14, it says, "Behold, I will make my words fire in your mouth, and this people wood, and it will devour them." In 10:10, it says, "The Lord is the true God and the God of truth. He is the living God and the everlasting King. So whom then shall we fear?" In Jeremiah 5:22, he explains that he placed the sand for a boundary of the sea, a perpetual burial beyond which it cannot pass, and by an everlasting ordinance beyond which it cannot go. "And though the waves of the sea toss and shake themselves, yet they cannot prevail against the feeble grains of the sand which God has ordained by nature to be sufficient for his purpose. Yes. Though the billows roar, yet they cannot pass over that barrier." In Jeremiah 10:12-13, it says, "God made the earth by his power. He established the world by his wisdom and by his understanding, and he still stretched out the heavens. When he utters his voice, there is a tumult of waters in the heavens, and he causes the vapors to ascend from ends of the earth. He makes lightnings for the rain. He brings forth the wind out of his treasuries and from his storehouses." So again, I ask, whom then shall we fear? If this God that spoke to the waters to stop at the seashore, he made the earth by his power, he established the world by his wisdom, why don't we trust this same God to send us forth in his power and in his might? There truly is nothing impossible with God. He won't fail us. He's longing for his children to stand up in these last days and profess his truth. The earth moans and groans for his reality to manifest. Yes. So to wrap it all up, here's what I feel like God was revealing to my spirit. Just go. Yeah. Speak his word to the people that you encounter. Listen to his voice and go with his power, the power of his word. Mm-hmm. For he will give us the words to speak. He's not only anointed our mouths, we now have the anointed one living in us. And when we do speak his truth, it will be like fire. His word will fall on deaf ears and be as of like a fire in which they cannot deny the truth. The word will accomplish the thing it was sent to do. And just like the people in the days of Jeremiah, they will just stand in amazement. We are called as prophets in this last day. Do not fear, for things are possible with our God. the God who created the heavens and the earth, the God that spoke everything into existence. He is with you, and his grace will sustain you. Yes. So, amen. I just feel like he's longing for us to just step out, and if he gives you a word, just go. Just go with that thing, and you never know what it's going to do. Like we've said this all along, you never know whose heart it's going to touch, whose life it's going to change. So I just encourage us all today to stand in that truth, be a prophet for this end time.
Amen.
So with that, anybody have a testimony or prayer request? Yes, Mike. Okay. My cousin, Donnie, some of you know Donnie, he's been here before. That fatal shooting that happened a couple days ago, that was his cousin. So just keep him and their family in your prayers. Anybody else? Yes, James. Yes.
And then I'm leaving for Arkansas on Friday this week. And it's supposed to be a thing with Bob Joyce, is the eldest type Christian guy in the name of Jesus. It's going to be interesting to have a little burn arm from work and hope that feels good. And,
amen. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
For Evelyn, she just had a lot of trouble with her legs and not wanting to move.
Yes. Amen.
Yes. I had a family friend that had a hip replacement and had a staph infection, so they had to remove the replacement and have a placer. She's going to have another hip inserted and has some other underlying health issues, diabetes and different things. And so, ginger.
Yes. Amen. Okay. In the name of Jesus, glory. Alvin.
Oh, his love is so, and his word is so wonderful. You know, a few days ago, why do we do it? Somebody says something or does something, and we take it so personal, and I'm listening to tape on that should not bother you, and so time with the Lord and the release and the joy restored,
yes,
that's just beyond expression, and working. No, just giving. The word will do it. You have to just give yourself, and the Lord will use you and prosper you. And,
yes.
And so those words fall off like water on a duck's back. They just roll off.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Yes,
Lord.
And I feel it'd be so
you, Jesus.
If we wouldn't receive what he offered, purchased.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Yes, Lord.
Yes, I continue to ask for prayer for her. She was like a spiritual mother to me when I got saved. I used to go down to her house, and she had a bunch of books about God, you know, and I'd ask her a lot of questions. And she had a bad fall. She lives out in Arizona, and she's in her 80s, and she just had a marvelous life about her. You know, I look at her as one that really helped set me on the pathway, and I thank the Lord for her. And just
yes.
Her name is Margie, and if you pray for her,
yes.
I appreciate that. And also appreciate prayer for my nephew. Him and his wife, they have gone through some things. They have 8 kids together. So it's just a lot of things happening there. And then I asked for prayers for Miss and I. We're going to go in the state. I was State Fair Parade for DMAC on Wednesday. And I always like prayer for that, because the hardest thing for us, we're going to take a semi down there, is getting in, getting
yeah.
out of there.
Yeah.
Getting, you know, because there's so much traffic down there.
Yeah.
People running in front of us and stuff down there, so ask prayers for that. But
yes,
one thing always that got me in the Bible was just really how much that God loves us, you know, and the fact he's been with us from the beginning to the end. And
yes.
I love the scripture you said, because before we was formed in our mom's
yeah.
belly, God knew us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He had plans for us, and you know, and it, those plans, you know, it's just like your regular children. You always want them to do well. I mean, that's what you want. Well, God wants the same thing for us.
Yeah. Right.
He loves to see us do well.
Right.
And loves to go into the bed that we're positioned for. You know,
yes.
we're made for a reason.
Yes.
We didn't come on this earth for a reason. I say that in class sometimes about what's most important to me on the road. It's the people.
Right.
Don't just think about people in the car, people that we don't know. They didn't get here by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So somebody birthed them into the world, and every one of them is valuable.
Right.
And that's what we always have to remember about ourselves. Sometimes we look at everybody else, oh, they're valuable. You know, sometimes we don't look at ourselves the same way. But we're just as valuable because Christ died for us too.
Right.
So I just want to praise the Lord.
Yes, thank
Amen.
You, Lord.
Christ, and you will be saved,
yes.
you and your household.
Yes.
Well, he's
Yes.
I will restore health to you.
Yes, Lord.
And heal you of your wounds.
Yes.
Says the Lord.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen. Glory.
Amen.
Glory. Right. Yes. And remember, just like I read, he said his word is fire.
Yes,
so where we take that thing, it has to devour the lies that are trying to come against that word.
That's right.
So let's all stand and we'll just go to the Lord in prayer and believing these things are done.
Yes.
And settled, because his word is power. And it is truth. Thank you, God. We just love you, Lord, and we praise you, Lord, for everything, God, that was mentioned here today, Lord. You said that we speak your truth, Lord. Your truth is like fire, God. It goes out. It presses on the ears of the people, God. And the healings take place, God. Salvation takes place, Lord. We know, Lord, that all things are possible through you, Lord. You formed us in our mother's wombs, God. You've set us apart, God, for this time. And we are doing just as you said, Lord. We are taking this word out, Lord. We are speaking to these situations, God, to say no more. No more will they rule and reign. We know that you rule and reign, God. We know that you are the only truth, the God, the living God. Foundation of this earth, Lord. You formed it with your hands. There is nothing impossible for you, God. We just thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord, for your people. Your people that are going to carry this word out, God, in these last days. Thank you, Jesus, for your love, God. The love of your children, Lord. You said it is a promise for our seed. And it will go down, Lord. The line, the inheritance is ours. It is for our children, God. We just thank you, Lord, right now. We thank you, God, for the victory in your word. Thank you, God, for the victory over all things, because you are in us. You are in us, God. We love you, Lord. We praise you, God. I pray, Lord, for this service, God, that your word will continue to pierce our ears, God. Change our hearts, Lord. The earth moans and groans for your people, God, to stand and declare this truth. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, God, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Oh.
Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your word, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Does somebody want to stand in the gap for someone who's not here? Is there anyone in your family who needs a touch from the Lord that's not here that you can stand in the gap for right now? Come on, come on, come on, come on. I know the Lord wants touch. Come on. Come on, church. Come on, church. There's people in our family that are dying. Don't love the Lord. You don't want to touch and stand in the gap for them to stay.
Thank you.
you, Lord. Should just worship, start worship. That's what I think. Then roll right into it. Yeah. I think we should just roll right into worship right now. God inhabits the praises of his people. He's already here in this room. So let's just roll right into it.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, God.
Hallelujah.
The words are true,
hallelujah.
God.
Hallelujah.
Oh,
was never able to release this song until I got here. And when Pastor declared that word Wednesday night, we're just going to talk about the scripture. So just hang on. Yeah, I know the fair is getting closer, and I know there's a lot of country music going to be played at the fair and stuff like that. So I guess some of that's drifted in here this morning. Hallelujah.
Blood more peace. acknowledging the Christ that's in us, we are a walking prophecy.
Yes.
And that's the heart of God,
yes,
is that he be revealed, that his revelation be seen in each and every one of us. So let's give him a big hand this morning. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you, Jody. Thank you, everyone, for sharing your testimonies and prayer requests this morning. It's a privilege for us to be able to enter into agreement with you and with the Word of God to see that Word manifest in all of our lives. Praise the Lord, in the lives of those that we are praying for and that we care about. Amen. God is good. Praise the Lord. And appreciate everybody being here this morning. Thanks again, Jody, for your words this morning. Blessed me, and it also confirmed the word that God had given me. Praise the Lord. And so from the mouths of others I know that have spoken their, you know, testimonies, prayer requests, and just the challenges that are before them, how that God wants to really manifest and work through each and every one of us. You know, we'll just get right to the Word of God this morning, and I'll spare you all of my usual ramblings while I'm trying to figure out what I'm going to do. Praise the Lord. I don't know if that was meant for me or somebody else. Praise the Lord. All right, let's start with Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse 29. Ecclesiastes 7 and 29. I did find this, though, and I wouldn't ask you to raise your hand, but got a free beer here for somebody if you ever get back to the Erie Lodge. It's not mine, but if I find out where this is, I'll be redeeming it. Praise the Lord. Don't feel bad. It's all good. Amen. I know what you find in a few. It's kind of like under the couch. Gold mine. Praise the Lord. Okay. Well, let's get right to this. Lo, this only have I found, that God hath made man upright, but they have sought out many inventions. Praise the Lord. Let's read it one more time. Keep this in your thinking while we move through this morning. Lo, this only have I found, that God hath made man upright, but they have sought out many inventions. All right, let's go to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26 through 31. I guess I turned my mic on. Reach back there again, I'll be turning it on. Okay, and God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over everything, or every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree in the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed to you, it shall be for meat. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat, and it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good, and the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Praise the Lord. So this is just kind of drawing out from what we read in Ecclesiastes, but let's look at Genesis chapter 3 now, verses 6 and 7. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, this is not what I want. This is Genesis 3, verse 6 and 7. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took up the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and made themselves aprons, praise the Lord. So it's just, you know, as Ecclesiastes said, God makes man upright and then man screws everything up. And the truth is, the human race has this strange ability to complicate life. And in doing so, they complicate salvation. Yes. Praise the Lord. And through traditional doctrines and expectations, religion has made it almost impossible for people to truly come to Christ.
Right.
Amen. But that isn't God's plan. I believe salvation should be easy. God said he made us upright. Amen. And if we would just stay within the plan of the creation, everything would be cool. Praise the Lord. So let's look a little further into this. God makes everything pretty simple. I mean, I know it's complex if you start digging into the atoms and the, you know, all the things that create that the earth is created or is created in the earth. But the truth is, it's very simple to understand in terms of how life is to be lived, how we are to interact with God, and how God intended for us, amen, to accomplish what he wants us to accomplish, which is this prophetic word that we were talking about earlier, that God wants to do something in each of our lives, and it's not that complicated unless we get involved. Our flesh, praise the Lord, and it just complicates everything. Let's look at this in Romans chapter 8 and verses 29 and 30. And I'll try to show you what I believe the Lord is showing me. Praise the Lord. Romans 8, verses 29 and 30. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. You can see the kind of the parallel here between Jeremiah and what's being spoken of here by Paul. Whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. Whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. Praise the Lord. So I'm not going to get into the predestination thing. We'd be here all day just fussing over it, but that's not my point. But when Paul wrote that, we were predestined, what he's saying is we were formed with a purpose.
Yes.
And God knew the purpose before he formed us.
Yes.
Amen. We were already in the mind of God. And God has this purpose, and he formed us with a purpose. Amen. And so the same simplicity of definition here can be used for the words foreknow, foreknew, called, justified, and glorified.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. I know that's not complex. I mean, people want their theology to be really deep and involved and confusing. Amen. That way they can just develop their own. Amen. As they go along. But if you look at it, amen, on the surface, yes, it takes us deeper in the word, but the word is an explanation in itself. If you want definition in the word of God, just continue to read the word of God and you'll get your definition. I mean, it explains itself. You're not going to get explanations outside of that. Amen. So think about this. Let's look at this again. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. So just leave that up there, but let's look at it this way. For those God thought about ahead of time, he also formed with a purpose. To be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And to those whom he formed with a purpose, he also communicated that purpose to them. And to those whom he communicated their purpose, he also fulfilled this purpose for them through Christ. And to those for whom he fulfilled this purpose in Christ, he also honored them both now and forever. Say praise the Lord. Amen. So that's really what this scripture is saying. And what it's saying is that God is so good, he spent eternity past thinking about us. All of us. Amen. Okay, so then because of his goodness, he created us with a purpose, which was to become like Christ, or to be the way it's spelled out in the scripture, is to be in Christ.
Yes.
That's the purpose. Praise the Lord. It's not complicated
unless
we get involved in the definition. Praise God. He thought about us for eternity past with a purpose in mind. and created us for that purpose. And everything, the calling, the direction, everything in our life is to bring about that purpose.
Yes.
And that purpose is to be in Christ. Yes. Not to be aware of Christ, not to know about Christ, not to be able to talk about him, but to be in him, to be one with Christ.
Yes.
Amen. So the plan didn't end there. Then God begins to reveal to us through the law and the prophets, amen, he begins to open up what his purpose was for us to be included in Christ. That's the Bible, praise the Lord. That's what the Bible's teaching us, hallelujah. This is made known to all of humanity through the Word of God and the testimony of creation itself. Let's look at this in Romans chapter 1. Verses 19 and 20. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Amen? So even better than that, not only did God think of us ahead of time and create us with a purpose and then tell us what that purpose was, he also fulfilled that purpose for us through Jesus Christ. He is the beginning and the end. He is the Alpha and the Omega, praise God. Everyone who accepts or embraces this gift will be glorified by God now and forever.
Yes.
Now here's what blows my mind. Here's how Paul responds to the words that he just spoke. Romans chapter 8, verse 31 through 35. You ever tell somebody, you're telling somebody something that they didn't know about, or it's, you know, kind of a shock to them, and they'll say, shut up.
Yeah.
Right? That's what Paul says. What shall we then say to these things? In other words, he's saying, you've got nothing to say. From what I just told you, the best response you can have is shut up.
Yeah.
Amen? Just accept it. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?
Yes.
He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Amen?
Yeah.
Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It's Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us.
Yes.
Who shall separate us from the love of God or the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Amen? So realizing how much God has done for us, we shouldn't have anything to say other than amen.
Yeah.
Right?
Amen.
What shall we say? He's not really asking for an answer to that. He's saying, what do you got? What are you going to say to this?
Yeah.
What can you say to this?
Right.
He had a purpose for you.
Yes.
Before you existed, before your mama existed, before your mama's mom, before anybody, before Adam and Eve existed, he had a purpose for your life.
Yes.
Now, I've got to think that that's got to be pretty important.
Yes.
If for eternity past he's been thinking about me with a purpose in mind and then creates me in that for that purpose and to that purpose and to that end I was created, then I ought to be seriously thinking about operating in that purpose.
Yes.
Amen? Because that's the only reason I'm here.
Yes.
I'm not here to take up space. I'm not here to procreate. I'm here, amen, to fulfill a purpose that God had designed for me. Now, with that design and with that purpose, sure, there are peripheral things that happen. You get married, you have kids, and the kids, amen, become a part of that purpose as well.
Yes.
But my purpose is to find my purpose.
Yes.
And to fulfill that purpose, which is clearly fulfilled in Christ.
Yes.
So it would behoove me to be in Christ.
Yes.
Would it not? All of us,
yes,
hallelujah, have this purpose, praise the Lord. Everybody who accepts this is blessed. Everybody who accepts this glorifies God.
Yes.
Praise God. The knowledge of God's goodness is the key to experiencing his power.
Yes.
You know, I'll go back to the prophecy, the spirit of prophecy. Every move of God no matter how much we have accepted or received it or not, every move of God, every true move of God came by the Spirit of God, which is the spirit of prophecy. And as long as that move points to Jesus, as long as that move is elevating Jesus, is magnifying Jesus, God's all for it, and the Holy Spirit's right there in the midst of all of it. The moment it becomes about men or a man or a woman, the Holy Spirit politely leaves and lets us do our thing with what God started, only to see us flounder. I mean, how many revivals have we seen and experienced where it was dynamic and the Holy Spirit's moving and everything's great, and then maybe a week, 2 weeks, a month or something happens later, and we decide we're going to keep this thing going and we've got it figured out now? Well, we can keep it going, but nothing's really happening except us. Because the Holy Spirit has already left, it's now become about us or our denomination or our particular church or this thing or that thing, and the Holy Spirit's not involved anymore. It's just us. Praise the Lord. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. And this is, we're back to the eating some meat here instead of just drinking milk and calling it meat. I mean, it's time that we really begin to find out what eternity past has declared our destiny to be, and then get in that destiny and see God fulfill it. He's the one that's going to have to do it, but he's only going to do it by his Spirit. He's not going to do it by our flesh. Praise God. So according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. So according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Praise God. So this isn't talking about intellectual knowledge, but an intimate, experiential knowledge and relationship with God. The truth is never known until it's experienced. That's why we say we have revelation. What we have is knowledge. It isn't truth until it becomes our truth. Until it's an experiential truth, it's just out there. And we can receive it and accept it, reject it, or do whatever we want to. But once we experience that truth, it becomes truth.
Yes.
And that's what Jesus said. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. He is truth. When we receive that truth, we are free. We are set free. Praise the Lord. Yes. Truth just isn't known. It's experienced. Praise God. John chapter 8 and verse 32. How many of you remember when you were a kid? When I was a kid in school, they didn't have computers. They had flashcards. Praise the Lord. 2 plus 2, 4 plus 4. And you learn by, well, rote, I guess, is one way of saying it. But you also, you learn just simply by hearing it over and over and over. It wasn't like I became a math genius. I just finally figured out that 2 plus 2 is always going to be 4. You see it often enough, pretty soon it becomes a truth to you. Before that, it was just kind of vague and, you know, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. For them, it's true, but maybe not for me. So the more you receive it, the more you see it, the more you hear it, the more it becomes a truth to you, and then you begin to experience it when you start actually trying to make change for a dollar.
Right.
Hallelujah. Well, as a kid, I worked for my dad. He had a couple of businesses, and one of them was a gas station and a fuel service and all that stuff. And I had to work. I worked in that gas station from the time I was about 9, 10 years old until I was out of school, and I learned pretty fast how to make change. I was never real good at math, but I could make change because it came out of my pocket if I made the mistake. I mean, if I came up short, if the register came up short at the end of my shift, I paid the difference.
Yeah.
Dad didn't just go, oh, well, he hasn't quite mastered math yet. We'll work with him. No, it's like anything else. You take a bad check, you collect the check, or you pay for the check. You know, we got paid an adult wage, and he expected us to operate like adults, even though we were juvenile delinquents, praise God. I'm just saying, you learn things by experience. I mean, they become truth to you because they become personal to you. I mean, you can talk to me all you want to about abstract things, but the things that I've experienced myself, I know to be true because I've experienced it. I know it's real, you know. You can't take that away from you. You have experience in Jesus. You can hear all of the scientific evidence and all the other things for whatever you want to talk. You can argue about dinosaurs and, you know, the creation and everything else and where all this fits in, and was it billions of years ago or was it 6,000 years ago? It doesn't make any difference.
No.
Once you've had an experience,
right,
a genuine experience in God, you know, they can't take it away from you. You know some truth.
That's right.
That no, they may have more intellect than you. They may have a greater resume of education, but they cannot take from you what you know to be true. What is experienced in you is a reality.
Amen.
Amen. And so ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free.
Yes.
Praise God. Information can't set anybody free.
No.
Right.
But truth experienced is freedom.
Yes.
And that's what Jesus is talking about. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. He's talking about, if you experience me, you're going to be set free. I mean, if you genuinely experience me, there's freedom that comes with that.
Yes.
Amen? Praise God. Anytime you hear a message that questions God's love or God's power, you're listening to a message of Antichrist.
Sure.
Right.
Now, we're waiting for some weird-looking thing to come floating down, you know, with some bizarre something about him that we'll be able to define as Antichrist. The truth is, we're hearing about we're receiving Antichrist teaching all the time. It went on clear back to the first century. Paul talked about the Antichrist. The Spirit's already among you. He said it's already here. So we deal with an Antichrist spirit every time we diminish Christ, every time we take away from God, every time that we try to, you know, humanize him some way. Amen. We get the direct opposite of what Christ came to accomplish, thereby speaking Antichrist to other people. Praise God. We need to lift up Jesus. Jesus needs to be, amen, not just the spirit of prophecy, but the fulfillment of all prophecy. Of every prophetic word that goes out of our mouth, it ought to come somehow, you know, establish the word of God in our lives and in the lives of the people that we interact with. So look at Mark chapter 7, verse 13. And this isn't a question of us laboring. This is a finished work. It's us yielding to it. Amen? Becoming aware of it so that then you can yield to it. So making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which ye have delivered, and many such like things do ye. Now, you know, what I'm talking about today, I suspect it's taught, you know, all over the place, but not seriously. I mean, it's just kind of always a kind of a fringe thing that's just out there, so we don't prioritize it. So we just go through life stumbling along, thinking that God's just going to come along and fix the mess, you know. And he does. He does good out of our stupid, you know. He makes positive out of our negative. But how much more would be accomplished if we could get in sync?
Yes.
I mean, if we walked with God instead of away from God, the Holy Spirit's always yanking us back, trying to get us back on the path. Amen. If we just walked the path in the first place.
Exactly.
Hallelujah. In making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which you have delivered, and many such things that you do. Praise God. All right. Galatians chapter 2, verse 21. I mean, let's keep it simple, stupid.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, that's the old KS kiss.
Yeah.
And we just love to complicate it.
Yeah.
Which is no wonder we've got all these schisms going on all the time.
Uh-huh.
Everybody's got their own little thing they think they got figured out, do this, do that, and so forth.
Yeah.
I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. So whenever we try to buffer God's willingness or God's ability by holding on to man-made regulations or experiences, we nullify the grace of God and cause it to have no effect. God's plan for us is beyond our imagination. It's even beyond our expectation, no matter how great that expectation of yours may be. Believe me, God had an eternity past to set this thing up. Plan, the purpose.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. And we just want to dumb it down to something that's about me. Right? Instead of what it should be about him. Praise God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. It's written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Again, he's had eternity past to decide what it is that he wants to prepare for us, to purpose us. Amen? You cannot outthink God's goodness.
No.
It's limitless. Mm-hmm. He is love. He's a good God.
Yes.
And you're not going to be able to think past that goodness.
That's right.
Romans chapter 5, verse 5. Ever have anybody tell you, I've just lost hope. I've lost hope in this kid. I've lost hope in this marriage. I've lost hope in my job. I've lost hope in healing and deliverance. I've lost hope in my health. You know, I'm just, hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. So I got a very simple thing to say to you right now, and that is, hope doesn't disappoint. So get your hopes up.
Yes.
Oh, I don't want to get my hopes up. I'll be disappointed. Get your hopes up. Hope will not disappoint.
Right.
We're afraid we're going to just, I'll be disappointed. Well, get over it, man. I mean, get your hopes up and trust God.
Right.
Amen. Right. Believe that he is who he says he is. Believe that he has a plan for your life, a purpose for your life, and it will come to pass if you will just yield to it and keep up your hope. Hope in God. Get your hope up. Because God is faithful. You can have hope no matter what it looks like, because God will not leave you or forsake you. You can be in him. Not just with him. You can be in him as he is in you. You can be one. In fact, you are one. You just need to experience it for that to be a reality for you. It is true. It just hasn't experienced. We haven't experienced it to the degree that we have to experience it in order for it to become truth. That will set us free and thereby set free those that we have contact with. The people that we bring revelation to, prophecy to, can be set free.
Yes.
Praise God.
Lord.
2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. 2 Timothy 2, 11 through 13. It's a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. How many times have we read this? Mm-hmm. I'm crucified with Christ, Paul said, and yet, nevertheless, I live. But it's not me that lives, it's Christ in me.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So we need to meditate on some of this.
Yeah.
We need to be muttering this back to ourselves on a regular basis. Faithful saying, if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself.
Right.
Praise the Lord. And that's verse 12. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us.
Yes.
Now that's not God saying, I'm writing you off because you haven't believed me for this situation or for that situation. No, it goes back to the book of Romans, where he says, I will, if your traditions, if your belief system somehow doesn't allow for grace,
right,
then you're frustrating grace and you're not going to get the benefits of the grace. And that's what he's talking about here. If you deny what I'm doing in your life, then you're not going to get the benefit from it. Doesn't mean that he isn't doing it. Doesn't mean he hasn't made it available. It means because of either our stupidity or our arrogance or our stubbornness, we don't get the benefit, amen, of everything that God has pre-planned,
yes,
purpose for our life.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. So if we don't believe, he abideth faithful. He can't deny himself.
Right.
Praise God. Amen. Even when we're faithless, God remains faithful. Why? Because it's impossible for God to disown himself.
Yes, exactly.
Now listen to what I'm saying. He can't disown himself without disowning you. And he can't disown you without disowning himself. All right. So get your hopes up. Because we are married to Christ. Our reality is perfectly and permanently fixed to his.
Yes.
That's this whole thing about the marriage. You know, we're thinking it's about, you know, here, how to fix your, you know, dysfunctional marriage. Of course, he's talking about that in the sense that we have to, you know, submit ourselves to one another and so forth. But he's actually talking about his relationship to us.
Yes.
And he gives us a metaphor or a parable that we can relate to, which is something natural that we experience all the time.
Yeah.
But we're married to him, and as God says, we become one flesh.
Yes.
What God has joined together, let no man put asunder.
Yes.
Amen. God has made us one.
Yes.
With him.
Yes.
We're fixed with that identity. It can't be changed.
No.
How many know there's no divorce in heaven? Not even legal separations work.
Right.
Praise God. You're in. You're in for the whole thing. Praise
yes.
God. Forever. For eternity.
Yes. Yes.
Praise God.
Thank you,
Jesus. You know, sometimes, you know, I worked construction years ago, and all I ever did was rough-in work and roofing, because I just don't have patience for the little detail stuff. Mm-hmm. Not get in a hurry and then leave that for the painters to fix, you know.
Yeah.
Praise God. But sometimes demolition is the only way to fix a thing.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had some stuff that just had to be tore up to be fixed. It was just such a mess that you couldn't just add to it.
Right.
It had to be torn down and rebuilt.
Yeah.
And that's what we see in the Word of God. The problem is we look at it through human eyes, I guess, because our image of God is goodness, faithfulness,
yes.
and love. But that image has been distorted. It's been messed with. It's been deconstructed and reconstructed and
yes.
added to and developed on and all these other things. But look at Matthew chapter 26 and verse 61. Matthew 26, 61. And said, this fellow said, I'm able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the difference between Jesus and the words that he spoke and those of a lot of preachers today is that he didn't just destroy the temple, leaving it in ruins. In other words, you're all screwed up and you're never going to get it together. You're going to bust hell wide open, and why don't you get your act together, and how many times do I, you know, we have to go over the same stuff, and you're going back to the same mess, and you're, you know, this hog to its wallow, and blah, 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 and what horrible people you are, and God knows if you could be saved or not. I don't even know. Only God knows, and it's just going to be a, you know, a tremendous challenge for you and for God to get you, amen, where you need to be. Praise the Lord. That's destroying the temple. No, you're not. You're the temple of God.
Yes.
All right? Well, Jesus, the difference between Jesus and a lot of preachers is that he didn't just destroy the temple, leaving it in ruins.
Right.
He took the time to rebuild it.
Right. Yes.
Amen. Know ye not, you are the temple of God.
Right.
So Jesus said, destroy this temple, and I'll mess with you like you can't imagine. I'm going to have a temple that goes everywhere, that is in everybody, that can be seen anywhere and everywhere. And so, you know, you think you're destroying.
Yeah.
You're just demolishing something so this thing can be built on a scale that has never been imagined before by anyone, anywhere. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. He took the time to rebuild it. We are new creatures in Christ, the temple of God. Amen. And our false beliefs incriminate God. And they justify our unbelief. And it robs the world of God's good intentions and unconditional love towards them. This is the purpose that God had for you in eternity past, is that you would not be the firstborn among many brethren, which was a perfect revelation of God in the flesh for humans to see, but a brother or a sister after the likeness of that firstborn. And your purpose is to reveal Christ.
Yes.
Your purpose is to walk in Christ. To recognize that wherever you go, Christ goes with you.
Yes.
He wants to be manifest. He wants to be revealed. He wants to be seen. He wants to give hope where there is no hope. He wants you to be that temple reconstructed. Amen?
Amen.
The revelation of that is for the sake of loving others and pointing people to Jesus. He communicates that purpose to us through the Word of God, through your own relationships. Think of I know a little bit about what Tammy's talking about because she's family. And I can tell you, it's very difficult to do what she's talking about doing with a son. But how much more difficult would it be for somebody who lives down the block? But you see, the purpose that God has for Jared is the same purpose that he has for the jerk down the street who lets his dog crap in your yard all the time. Say, praise the Lord. Amen. You know, I'm being facetious, you know, and just kind of joking around about it, but this is serious. This is your purpose.
Yes.
And how many of you know, if you ever find your purpose, you're free?
Amen.
Everybody, I mean, I heard it said many, many times, if you find a job that you love, you'll never work a day in your life. Why? Because you found your purpose. And every day is a fulfillment. Every day fulfills you. It doesn't challenge you in the sense that you're just wore out and stressed and bummed out and sick and tired of going to that same office or that same job or doing this and doing that. All of a sudden you, bum, this is what I was created for.
Yeah.
And every day that I walk in that purpose, God is glorified and I'm satisfied. I'm fulfilled. I'm free. I'm free. Huh?
Yes.
And nobody can take that freedom from you.
No.
Because it's your freedom. And it's freedom in Christ.
Right.
They can't touch you.
Right.
Can't touch me. Can't touch me. Don't judge me. Praise the Lord. My granddaughter loves to say that. Don't judge me. You won't care. Judge on.
Yes.
Because it doesn't affect me.
No.
Because I'm free.
Yes.
I know my identity.
Yes.
I know who I am. I know what my purpose is.
Right.
And it's in Christ.
Right.
And no matter what you think, no matter what you say, it doesn't change that.
Right.
I can be at peace with me, with God, and even your questions and doubts.
Amen.
Doesn't touch, doesn't affect me anymore.
Amen.
Find a purpose and you'll find life.
Yes.
Yeah.
Praise God. James Taylor sung a song once. I can't remember the name of it now, but I remember some of the words, and the words were, the secret to life is loving the passage of time. That's easy to say when you're 20.
Yeah.
Not so much at 68. Unless you found a purpose and claimed it as your own.
Come on.
Every day is a good day.
Yes.
Amen. And every day is one more day of peace, of joy, of freedom, and fulfillment.
Amen.
A lot of people. I mean, I worked a lot of different kinds of jobs in my life. None of them brought me much satisfaction. Some brought me more money than others. But none of them really brought much satisfaction. They brought more frustration and aggravation than they did anything else. But I didn't have time to keep trying different jobs. So I just decided to be a preacher. I'm kidding. But I know some of you already thought that, so you throw it out there for your consideration. Praise the Lord. But I guess what I'm saying is I found a purpose. And believe me, there's plenty of frustration in pastoring and disappointment and all the other stuff. But there is a fulfillment. There is a satisfaction that comes even with all of that.
Sure.
That makes it okay to do it.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
I've had other jobs where, you know, you just get have a problem with a sales manager, you have a problem with some CEO, somebody else, and it just drives you crazy. I got problems with somebody every day, all the time, because I'm opening my mouth, and that just leaves you subject to being challenged, amen,
yeah.
And questioned. But I don't worry about it. Ask my wife. She worries about it. I don't have to. There's no point in both of us worrying and be redundant. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. She doesn't. I'm just saying, I just don't.
Exactly.
Hey, I can't help what other people think.
Sure.
I just try to say it in a way that's maybe a little more understandable.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
Yep. But you can have a purpose no matter what your job, no matter what your career is, no matter what else it is, there is a purpose that is so deeply ingrained in you. In fact, it's how God sees you. God sees you in your purpose. What is your purpose? In Christ. That's how God sees you.
Yes.
Think we ought to start seeing ourselves this way. That's why Paul said, I see only Christ and Him crucified. I don't see nothing else.
Yes.
I see your purpose.
Yes.
I see my purpose. Amen. And when we operate in that purpose, man, it's not hard to get along. It's easy to get along. Praise God. So the revelation that we have is the means by which we are able to love others, and by loving others, we point them to Christ. So our challenge is resist the urge to win arguments and force opinions, and instead, let's win them to truth and love to others. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5 and 7. It used to be, years ago, there was a guy on, I can't remember his name now, but he had a radio program on. He was a preacher. Well, I don't know if he was actually a minister or not, but anyway, and it was always, he was always against somebody. Not Lester Summerall, but it was, I can't remember who he was. He was not in a mainline denomination, but he was always on a tear. I mean, he was always aggravated at somebody. And just always hateful and just tearing people up all the time. I can remember listening to him. I used to listen to him all the time. He's one of my favorites, praise the Lord. Amen. He made me feel really free. He was definitely bound, but I'm just saying, he always had an argument. It was always an argument. I don't care. You could say, saw the sun come up this morning. Which direction did it come up? East. I don't know. I'm not so sure about that. I didn't see it come up in the east. I didn't see it. So I'm not going to take your word for it. You know, and just on that kind of craziness. And that's always what it was. Praise God. Instead of just, you know, win them to Jesus, not to your opinion.
Right.
You know, you don't win in the argument, you may lose the war. I mean, you may lose that person just because you won the argument. Who cares? The argument won't mean anything.
Right.
Now, the end of the commandment is charity out of a pure heart. That's love out of a pure heart and of a good conscience and of faith unfeigned. From which some have swerved, have turned aside into vain jangling. I'm saying, This is the call, and this is the vast majority of religion today. We've been called to the commandment of love out of a pure heart.
Yes.
And of a good conscience.
Yes.
And of faith unfeigned. You can't have the pure heart, the good conscience, and unfeigned faith without grace.
Right.
Amen. The commandment is love.
Yes.
Which some, having swerved or deviated from the truth or from the purpose,
right,
have turned aside into vain jangling, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, insurance, we've got insurance, praise the Lord. Desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor what whereof they affirm. The law is not the gospel.
Amen.
And our calling and our mission and our purpose is not to fix everybody's problems or to identify their problems.
Right.
Amen. Our calling is reconciliation, not condemnation.
Right.
You got nothing to lose by loving somebody who is not lovable. You have nothing to lose by accepting them in their condition.
Right.
Let God do it. Let the Holy Spirit fix them. Your job is to be like Jesus. Your job is to bring Christ into that situation. Look at Jesus with all the sinners that he had to deal with. He never had a problem with them. He loved them. He made himself available to them. Amen. And they either accepted it or they didn't accept it. But he just made himself available in a way that brought no demands on them other than to just receive the love, just receive the respect of one person to another. Reconciliation. Get them back with God.
Amen.
Do for them what somebody did for you. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 19. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. All things, all the things that have become new,
right,
you, are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and have given to us the ministry of reconciliation.
Yes.
It's another way of saying you've been set free, to bring freedom to others.
Right.
You've been reconciled to God so that you can be a reconciler.
Yeah.
Amen. To wit, that God was in Christ. He's given it away here. You know, he reconciled himself by Jesus Christ and have given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Now he says, now here's how it worked with him. God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and have committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now Christ is in you. So God is in you. So your job's the same. Nothing's changed. It's not complex. It's not religious. It's not theological, you know, heavy stuff. It's just simple. God was in Christ. Christ in you. You do what Christ did.
Yes.
And you'll get the results.
Yes.
You got to be one. Jesus was totally conscious of God's presence in his life.
Yes.
He was always aware,
yes,
that the Father is in me.
Yes.
He's doing the work. All I got to do is abide in him. All I have to do is walk in him.
Yes.
And he'll do what has to be done. I don't have to plan the next 6 months. I don't have to have a flow chart telling me every step I'm going to take over the next 6 months.
Come on.
God's already got a pre-plan programmed into me. If I'll just walk with him, it shall come to pass even as he has spoken.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Grow in intimacy and trust God.
There it is.
It's not just knowing about God or being able to defend him to somebody, but ultimately to have and maintain a real life-giving relationship with this God of love. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 1, and we'll wrap it up with this. I'm saying, wake up! You know, I don't know how to say this other than, you know, when I was in the service, those of you that have been in the military, overseas when I was in Vietnam, the number one thing you had to do was be aware.
Yep.
You didn't have to be, you know, you didn't have to be the best shot. You didn't have to be the strongest. You didn't have to be the biggest. You didn't even have to be the bravest. You just had to be aware of what in the world is happening around me.
Exactly.
The more aware you were, the longer you were going to live. Praise God.
Amen.
It's true in everyday life. The more we are aware of Christ, the less vulnerable we are to the things of this world. The more we are aware of Christ, the more conscious we are of His presence, the less of a threat anything else can be to us. Because we'll see it by the Spirit. We'll understand what it is, and we won't overreact. We'll trust in the armor, the weapons that God has imparted to us, that has trained us with. Amen?
Yes.
And we'll be victorious.
Yes.
Praise God. We then, as workers together with Him, beseech you also that you receive not the grace of God in vain. Praise God. So I'm just closing with this. To be in Christ is our destiny. It is the purpose of God for your life. It's God's purpose. It's God's plan. And it's your freedom. And your chance to not only be reconciled, but to be the reconciler that God preordained you to be and purposed you to be. A brother, a sister of Jesus Christ, a revelation of God on this earth. Can you say praise the Lord? Amen. Give Him a hand. Thank you. Now, I just challenge you, the next time somebody says, what do I got to do to be saved? Believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who believe that. Amen. And that He has a plan for their life that surpasses any expectation, any dream, any hope that they may have had. It will be a freedom finding moment. When they truly find Jesus, when they truly experience Jesus, they'll be set free.
Amen.
They'll be set free to be whoever they want to be in a way that will reveal Christ. We spend a lot of our time trying to fix ourselves emotionally, mentally, physically, when in fact all we need to do is find Jesus and then just relax and be yourself. Most of our fixing is the result of trying to build something on a foundation that can't hold it.
Right.
It needed to be demolished so that it could be built back up into the edifice that God intended it to be.
Lord.
That's true of each one of our lives.
Lord.
Amen.
That is.
Praise God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ who loves us. You're not just some weird person aimlessly wandering through life trying to figure out how many more years have I got before I go to heaven.
Right.
You are created not only with a purpose, but by a purpose and on purpose to fulfill the purpose of God in this world.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Give Him a hand clap again. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And you don't have to put a lot of weight on yourself. Just relax.
Right.
Stay conscious of God's presence, and He'll lead you and guide you into all truth.
Amen.
Praise God. You'll become truth, not just a recipient of it. You'll literally become truth to somebody else. Amen?
Amen.
God bless all of you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Go in the power of Christ in Jesus' name. Amen.
House of Prayer Friday night, 7 o'clock here.